Welcome and thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So you're in a residency right now.
Yes.
And basically writing commissions for a chamber ensemble and also a full orchestra piece. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Cool. Before we get into that, I'd love to talk about you and where you come from and your experience in music and why you're doing what you're doing.
Totally. So I have made my home Toronto for the last almost 20 years. Mm-hmm. Before that, I grew up in a small town in Ontario called Midland. And it's a small community. Was there till I finished high school, before moving to study music in Toronto. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, you know, growing up in a small town was an interesting experience, especially before we had lots of good internet stuff. And so one of the things that bothered me the most living there was I didn't have access to scores and things mm-hmm. like that. So I would love these trips down to the reference library in Toronto and mm-hmm. other places where I could read interesting.
How far is Midland from Toronto?
It's about a 2-hour ride.
Okay.
Car ride.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, so growing up in a small town, yeah, I then lived also for a couple of years in Japan.
No way.
Yeah. Okay. So after university, went there and I taught English, paid some bills or paid mm-hmm. some, you know, student loans. And then, yeah, made my home in Toronto ever since.
Cool. So you obviously studied composition at U of T?
No, I didn't.
No, at U of T? Okay, sorry, where?
So I first of all, I didn't study composition.
Okay, excellent. I love stories like this. Good.
Ooh,
okay, here we go. Let's get into it.
Here. Yeah, so I studied music as a kid mm-hmm. and had some really, really good teachers mm-hmm. Growing up. So teachers that pushed me and also pushed kind of my sound, you know, my sound world by showing me works. I remember a couple in particular stood out. I had a singing teacher who introduced me to Britten and mm. to Berg and to lots of the great operas. So that was fantastic.
Britten and Berg, that's a pretty good entry point.
It's a good entry point. And Peter Grimes and Wozzeck, they're some
yes.
amazing operas. Oh. Hulu, and Britten's got just, I still love and study those scores and love those works. And then another teacher who had records, so this is back in the day of the record. By the way, I'm 37, so this gives you my...
Yeah. I grew up with LPs too.
LPs, yeah. Yeah. And I remember records of Les Voix de Mystère, the Bulgarian voices of mm-hmm. Bulgarian choirs.
Oh, wow.
So women singing with these kind of really interesting rhythmic patterns and really mm-hmm. interesting, tension points. So like
unique, use of unique melodic and harmonic.
Absolutely. Too, yeah. Mm-hmm. Different structures, like different lengths of lines and that kind mm-hmm. of thing. So this just really opened my world. Armory Schaffer is another big one as a kid.
Great.
So yeah, that's where I really got the love of composing. But yeah, so just to get back to your studying, I went to the Glenn Gould School
and studied
piano performance there. And then I left and went to U of T and studied other things. So I studied English and I studied languages and did an undergrad. And that's the extent of my education.
Okay. So then I'm very curious now to talk about this because language obviously is a big part of your life. You moved to Japan to teach English. Did you study Japanese as well before moving there or did you...
Yeah, very, very little.
Okay.
So I had a kind of cursory understanding of Japanese and could maneuver through different settings, social settings, but it was pretty terrible, actually.
Where did you live in Japan?
Lived just outside of Tokyo,
okay.
in Chiba Prefecture.
Yeah. Excellent. It's my favorite country to visit.
Oh, it's amazing.
I love Japan. I love the culture. I love the music. I love the scenery, the food.
Oh,
it's unbelievable.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's such a different world, and I've not gotten back since 2004, so I look for, or 2006 rather, so I look forward to getting back there sometime.
Wow, great. So you are back in Canada mm-hmm. and living in Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
And where was the point where you decided composition is going to be mm-hmm. my mainstream right now?
Yeah. You know, I composed from as far back as I can remember and was always writing interesting works as a kid. Always sort of grand ideas. So mm-hmm. grand, like... opera ideas and these kind of things. And I would take often libretti or texts that I'd found that other composers had already set and then would work on them myself. So I did this through my, you know, elementary school and teen years.
Oh, cool.
And did quite a bit of writing then. And won some awards for that as a young composer. And did it even through my 20s. People would say, hey, can you write this for me? Can you write that for me? But it was only when I was about 30, in my early 30s, 32, that a good friend of mine who's an artist had a project in Toronto's Nuit Blanche,
okay,
and asked if I could do a soundscape for it. So that really was a way of coming back to composing.
Okay.
And then, you know, really, I asked myself, what do I want to say? What do I want to write? Who do I want to kind of work with? And then have constructed a career.
Aren't these the questions every composer has to deal with when they're like starting to think about what they're going to write next?
Absolutely.
What do I want to say?
What do I want to say? And I think really understanding limitations, you know, putting limitations or boundaries around what I was going to do. So one of the things I said was, I want to work on vocal work, so songs, mm-hmm. song cycles, opera, and what are the kind of component pieces that would be most helpful in terms of the type of work that I was going to be writing that can, you know, get me to a place to write opera mm-hmm. on a larger scale, that kind of thing.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So now we fast forward a little bit to this residency that you're participating in here at the NAC, this Carrefour. Could you please let our listeners know what exactly this is? It's a co-partnership with the Canada Council, correct?
That's correct, okay. Yeah. So Canada Council and the NACO got together and decided to sort of invest in emerging composers. Mm-hmm. In particular, this first round, these 2 years that I'm doing, they were looking for diverse composers. So I'm Métis by background and upbringing. And so this was, you know, this was a chance for young composers to have access to excellent players, opportunity to, you know, ask and discover all the questions mm-hmm. that you might have in order to write well for instruments and for the orchestra. Mm-hmm. So it came with two commissions. One was for a chamber work in the first year of the residency, and then one for a work for the orchestra in mm-hmm. the second year.
And you're the very first composer in this program. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Can you tell us about the first work you've been writing? This is mm-hmm. a chamber work, right?
Yes.
And is there a voice in this work?
There is, okay. Yeah. So I pitched a work that was setting poems of Joy Kogawa, who is a Japanese-Canadian poet. Mm-hmm. She's well known for one very important work in the early 80s called Obasan. And it was her experiences around the Second World War, growing mm-hmm. up in Canada, and with all of the racism that kind of existed in that mm-hmm. experience. And she is also just a wonderful poet, wonderful person as well. And she has a great collection of poetry. So I'd been reading through her work over the years and sort of culling poems that I thought could be great. So the cycle is five poems. And the cycle's called Where There's a Wall. Mm-hmm. And I'm writing them for six players in the orchestra and a mezzo-soprano, and mm-hmm. have the incredible fortune of working with Christina Szabo.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, congrats. Oh, that's fantastic.
Thank you. It's kind of like a dream come true, really. Yeah. Just such a great musician. All seven of them are incredible musicians. And when you get to hear... the last couple of days, we've been workshopping the piece, and mm-hmm. I've been sitting in rehearsals kind of... giddy, I guess.
Yeah, I can imagine.
you hear what you write, but it's being brought to life, like right. really brought to life. And that's not always the experience of hearing your work performed.
Well, it's like once you're ready, you have to let it go out there and totally. Be okay with it.
Totally. And let go.
Yeah, exactly. So what other instruments are in it? So you have mm-hmm. mezzo-soprano,
violin, mm-hmm. Viola, double bass. So no trouble. And then flute, clarinet, and bassoon.
Okay, so trio against trio in a
way. Trio against trio.
Yeah.
It's a kind of interesting septet, I guess.
Yeah.
But it also covers the kind of range of the instruments from low to high. And so there's quite mm-hmm. an interesting palette.
Lots
of
colors. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Can you tell us more about the work, mm-hmm. the inspiration, the title?
I'm totally.
Very curious.
Yeah, so the poems are... It really centered around this one called Where There's a Wall. The question of walls that we build, whether they be border walls, whether they be, you know, metaphorical walls to keep people away or to keep people separate, and how those are actually permeable structures that you can actually get around or over or through, and what are the means that we can get around or over or through. So I thought that was just a brilliant kind of idea, especially timely now. It's really a a set of poems that are about the fear of the other, fear of the outsider, fear of the of someone coming into our space and kind of changing it or ruining it somehow. And so it takes that perspective of being afraid of the outsider, and then the outsider's perspective of being kind of hated when they're in a space where they're kind of where they're rejected. And but then also the thought about the wall, that walls can be transgressed, walls can be broken down, and sometimes it's language, sometimes it's music or art that can do that. So it's a really the cycle takes us on a journey, really, through one woman's kind of experience of being hated, feeling isolated in this community, and then sort of embracing that and finding a voice within it.
Was she, pardon me for my ignorance, but I don't know too much about the poet, and were her experiences actually in Canada during the Second World War?
Yes, she was interred in the Second World War.
She really was, okay.
Her family home was sold by the government, and so it was a really terrible experience. And it's interesting, though, that she has then taken this traumatic experience and created wonderful work around it. Work that's really touched a lot of people. It's helped to bring awareness to some of these historic events and issues, but it's also given voice to artists to kind of find a way of expressing this as well.
It's, I mean, not necessarily light subject matter, but
no,
but powerful subject matter.
Certainly.
So I'm looking forward to hearing it, by the way. I love new music, especially. And I'm really curious to hear how, if you're willing to talk about it, how you musically set this material. What kind of, let's maybe explore what you consider to be your compositional style so that people have a sense of the way, what your language is and your voice.
You know, it's funny. It's hard to describe one's own style. I think the easiest way to describe it is what people tell me of it.
Okay, cool.
When I hear it, they'll say,
so what have you been told by other people?
What have I been told? I'll tell you what other people say. You know, I guess I would say this. I have a deep respect and love for the human voice. Mm. And for singers in particular, I think they're fascinating creatures. I mean, creatures in the best sense. They're wonderful people. And I've become very good friends. I mean, in fact, my wife is a singer. We met in music school.
Great.
So I've loved them too.
It sounds like this has been a very important staple of your musical upbringing since a very early age. If Wojtek, Lulu, I find it fascinating. You're talking about Wojtek and Lulu is like an entry point into music.
Oh,
that is
gosh.
A great entry point into music.
An incredible entry
Wojtek
point.
Wojtek and Lulu are like two of my favorite works.
They're incredible works.
Crazy, amazing.
Amazing structurally as well. Oh, we could talk for hours about just those two works alone.
Of course.
There's, some incredible just way he goes about taking structures that are sort of could be seen as rigid and constricting and then finds this incredible expression.
Totally.
We're sitting here in October talking and the orchestra just played the Berg violin concerto.
Yeah,
and
amazing work.
It's a masterwork. I mean, I forgive Berg for stopping writing Lulu and actually not finishing it to write this violin concerto because it's such a great work.
Mm-hmm.
But expressive, it's dark, it's moody, but it's just a thing of beauty.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Sorry.
That was a total trend.
We digress.
We can digress. So I would say I start with a voice. I think the voice informs a lot of what I do. In this case, the text and the narrative, the story, drives a lot of the way I think about the writing. So the musical writing would be sort of in response to that first material. I think, you know, often people will describe the lyrical nature of my writing. So it's there is a kind of lush and lyricism to it. But there's also an angularity to it and a darkness, a tension that comes with it. I like to play to those extremes. I like to have something that's exquisitely lyrical and then something that kind of turns it on its head and can be, you know, make us think differently about it. Also, I mean, another thing I like to think a lot about is density of sound, and then also kind of very spare and sparse sound.
So you're very aware of texture and space, spatial
and space.
Sound. Yeah,
I think that, you know, I've said this before, but one of the most important tools that the composer has is silence.
And I agree.
Knowing how to wield silence well, it's a very powerful tool in musical composition, but space and silence. So those are all things that inform the work. I mean, when people ask, what's your style?
I think I know, it's a loaded question. I apologize.
Not at all. It's a great question.
It's just a way to for to get a sense of what you consider to be the way you express yourself. I think it's interesting for people to hear it before they actually hear your music.
Totally.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the other question often I think is under that. And when I ask people, oh, tell me about your style, I'm usually asking sort of, who would you sound like?
Got it.
So if I were to answer that question, which I'll ask... I'd say composers that I've deeply admired have included in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. I mean, Berg, certainly. Mm-hmm. Messiaen, certainly.
Oh, yeah.
And of course, Stravinsky. But then the French composers as well. So Ravel, I mean, he's just such an incredible orchestrator.
So colorful.
Yeah. And then I love the German. So like Mahler, certainly, and Richard Strauss. So the operas, I just think, are wonderful mm-hmm. source of... I read them all the time because they're so...
Favorite beautiful. Strauss opera, go.
Huh. That's a really mean question.
I know.
I would narrow it down to Die Frau und Schatten, Elektra, and Der Rosenkavalier.
Nice.
All very, very different.
Yeah,
works.
Very different. Yeah.
But they're all great. Frankly, yeah. I think they're all great. And, you know, and what a bizarre career that he had.
Totally.
From one kind of one end to the other, and ending where he did it.
And the political spectrums he lived through, too.
Absolutely.
Quite fascinating.
And the types of works he was writing during the Second World War, Capriccio, mm-hmm. and these kind of lighter works, you kind mm-hmm. of... It raises a lot of questions and thoughts as
totally.
To why those then. But yeah, so they would say them. But then, of course, within the you know, older classical canon, there's... I mean, I really could say most composers have had some influence on me. Mm-hmm. Certainly Bach. You know, there's a lot of kind of Baroque structures that I think inform my music. So in this cycle, each of the five songs is based on some kind of formal structure. So there's a fugue movement, there's a passacaglia, there are structures that kind of come from Baroque and classical times. Mm. And then I think just, like early French opera as well, Lully, Rameau.
Wow.
And ornamentation.
So the whole gamut.
So there you go. How's that for a helpful answer?
meaning you'd like to be well versed on all music.
I mean, there's something wonderful in all of it. I think,
of course.
You know, that's it. It's having an attitude of discovery in all of it.
Nice. What
is there? And I mean, it's a world of discovery just mm-hmm. to go through the whole gamut of it.
So these poems, now that you said in your first work with us here, is it a multi-movement work, or does it flow seamlessly? How have you structured that?
Yeah, there's a clear break between the movements and the songs, and there are clear sort of, I would call them, attitude shifts between them. So there's even a perspective shift. The first poem is in the voice of the person who's being, let's call it, invaded from the outsider.
Okay.
And then the second to fifth take the perspective of the person who is finds themselves in a community where they have where they're rejected by because they've come to this place. So it has an attitude shift. I mean, yeah, but there's space and delineation between the movements.
I'm really looking forward to hearing this. When's the premiere?
November 4th.
Okay, November 4th.
And
here at the NAC.
It's going to be at the National Gallery.
Oh, at the National Gallery. Is this for the Music for a Sunday Afternoon series? Excellent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Being paired with Beethoven Septet.
Great.
Yeah.
Oh, what a cool program. So let's talk more about what your residency entails here, because this mm-hmm. is just the first work of two that you'll be writing for the orchestra.
Yes.
Have you started brainstorming about your full-scale work for orchestra?
Oh, yes.
Yeah? Okay.
The brain is already there. Well, you know, the second work, one of the things that I really wanted to... while this first work that we just discussed, the song cycle, doesn't directly relate to my own experiences as a Métis person.
Okay.
It has certain, clearly reference to it, this question of...
You have a kind of, you feel a connection to it?
I do, and I think that there are themes within the poetry itself that kind of reference the Métis experience in Canada. Mm-hmm. The second work will more explicitly do that. It's actually going to be, it's a 20-minute piece for the orchestra, and it's called Le Loup de Lafontaine. This is the wolf of Lafontaine, And this is a story that comes out of my own community. Mm. It's a story that I heard as a kid, and there's even a festival in my hometown, the Festival of the Wolf.
Excellent.
And so really the story is kind of half fable, half historic. There is a community that has settlers in it. It has indigenous people in it. But none of these communities really get along. They kind of exist in their own ghettos, if you will. We're talking small farming community in Ontario. And all of a sudden, the wolf comes to town and starts really terrorizing the town. It's described as, you know, finding a broken town and kind of capitalizing on the brokenness and that. Mm-hmm. And so the community has to kind of deal with this wolf. And then the community has to get together and kill the wolf. It's something that will then unify the town and these disparate communities. It's an interesting story to me, and it's always been a problematic one because this wolf is the villain, if you will, of the community. But it's also kind of the scapegoat. The wolf is the sacrificial lamb, if you will. Mm. There's a lot of different ways of reading that. So getting back to the work, I'm going to write a piece for the orchestra that'll be something that could almost be like a non-danced ballet, if you will.
Okay, sounds
really
cool.
A piece that could have movement at a later point. Yeah, it's gonna be fun work.
Well, to continue with the story, obviously the fable / historical story has a lot of significance in terms of what it's saying. So have you thought about maybe we're like talking about the secrets to your composition that we shouldn't get into yet, but maybe you want to surprise us all. But what kinds of ideas are percolating with how to approach that kind of source material?
Yes.
With the forces you'll have available to you, are you going to use purely orchestra? Is that a fair question to ask?
Okay. Yeah. So it'll be a purely orchestral. There will be no text, no song. But one thing I'm doing right now in the planning stages of the work is sort of fashioning a libretto for the work.
Okay.
So I'm creating a gentle narrative that could be printed in a house program so people can follow short movement by short movement what action.
So you want people to feel this sense of a program.
Absolutely.
To the work. Okay.
Yeah.
Is it going to be would you like to call it a program work, or
I mean, it's so hard for me, even when I've written just purely orchestral work, I will create a program even if I don't share that program.
Okay, cool.
I think, you know, I can't help but think narrative within a narrative thread in anything that I write. There's always an arc, there's always a kind of dramatic shape to it, and I can't escape that.
Okay.
In fact, I almost don't understand how to escape that, if you will. And I don't know that I ever would want to.
Okay. So here's a layman's question, because I've dabbled in composing a little bit by myself. I find it really difficult. Mm-hmm. How are you going to compose 20 minutes for a full orchestra? Is that something you've done before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's funny. It's always frightening at the beginning.
Yeah.
It's frightening thinking of sitting in a chair and, you know, as one generates ideas and then writes them down and fashions them and moves them around and figures them out. It's frightening. Knowing that I've gotten to the other side of that already, like knowing that I can complete a piece and this does happen, then I think I have to kind of relax. I think, you know, for me, it's just about wondering at the sound world of this place. Sometimes I'll kind of imagine the scene playing before my eyes, and then I listen for what accompanies or what exists there sound wise. You know, certainly I will also generate ideas, motivic ideas, gestural ideas, things that I kind of see as starting points. Mm-hmm. And then usually that just kind of is like a snowball. It starts going down the hill, and the piece is attached to it, and it becomes a fully fledged piece.
Cool.
The way I'll approach this work, as I do with a lot of my orchestral work, is thinking, you know, writing it in a short score form. So I don't, I'm not writing immediately for the orchestra, but I am thinking about color and texture and, okay. and those kinds
so
of
So when
things.
You say short score, are you going to sit, do you compose from the piano?
Often, yeah.
Yeah, great.
Both at and away from.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. So when I say short score, I just mean, usually it's something that you can't play by yourself on the piano.
Okay, got
in,
it.
In, you know, but it's on a number of lines mm-hmm. And it's, it kind of includes all of most of the detail of the mm-hmm. orchestral work that then has to be kind of elaborated when I go to orchestrate. Mm-hmm. I find the you know, it's funny, Strauss always said like the worst part of writing a work is the composing of it. When you get to orchestrating, it's just like you can have a conversation with someone and mm-hmm. orchestrate. And it's totally true for me.
When Interesting.
When I get to the stage of I'm thinking about the full orchestra, it's like I can watch TV and do it. It's that, it's
wow,
there. You
cool.
know?
I've often imagined it's akin to like coloring.
It's kind of like coloring.
Yeah.
and really, you know, yeah. you can make wrong choices, sure. Mm-hmm. But really, it's about making better choices. And sometimes it's saying,
I like
what's
that.
The best way to do this mm. or what's the more effective way of doing it? What and you know, for me too, it's about thinking about the player. What will they want to play, mm-hmm. And what's the best way to present that for them so that it gives the greatest ease when they actually sit to read the score.
Well, this is an interesting point. We've really talked about this on the series of podcasts, but it might be interesting to talk about what orchestration is for people who don't know what mm-hmm. that actually means. In essence, Ian's talking about which instruments and will be used to play certain material you've composed
yeah.
and how that will be set. So when
yeah.
we say color, we're referring to different instruments and their different colors.
Yeah.
And the choices you make, sometimes there are limitations to instruments, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So it's,
I mean, a great example would be if you think of playing a chord on the piano or on a guitar or on any instrument, you know, you could say a C major chord. So it is going to have a particular sound. When you think then, how will I get an orchestra to play that?
Mm-hmm.
You have almost an infinite number of options as to how do you do that. So for example, I could play that same chord in the strings only. I could play it in the very low strings. I could space those notes really far apart, or I could jam them together. And if I jam them together and put them really low in the say the double basses and the cellos, you're going to get a very certain type of
yeah.
sound. If I were to give that to a choir of clarinets and ask them to play it extremely high, you're going to get a very,
very
particular
yeah.
type of sound.
Yeah.
So it's the same
yeah.
chord,
mm-hmm.
but the choices you make within the families of the orchestra mm-hmm. will make it sound different. And then, of course, you don't have to have that same chord just in one family. It can
mm-hmm.
cross multiple
mm-hmm.
families. So every time I will think of how to space a chord out or how to where to place a particular like little melodic idea in the orchestra, I'm thinking mm-hmm. about the effect it'll have. The am I asking the player to play loud
mm-hmm.
or quiet? Can they do that in that part of their instrument?
Mm-hmm.
And what resulting sound will it have in relation to all the other sounds that are happening? It sounds insanely complex, and it kind of is.
It kind of is.
But it's also kind of amazing. It's,
yeah.
I think if you approach it from the perspective of you're playing with sound.
Yeah.
Then it's a lot of fun, actually.
Well, also, like, the nice thing about this entire residency, it's an opportunity for you and other composers that will come through this program now to workshop and test new things, right?
Oh, my gosh.
I mean, that's the whole point, is that we're the orchestra and the musicians are there for your
yeah.
use.
This is, I mean, I've got to tell you.
It's like a laboratory.
It is the one of the most exciting parts of this residency, and really, I have to remember it's such a unique opportunity because to work with musicians of this caliber and ask them not only technical questions but almost emotional questions
mm-hmm.
of like when you see that score, how does it make you feel? Like really, that's
okay.
I'm interested in that. Like does that make you want to just shut the score and like walk away crying?
Wow!
Or, because I think you know there are composers and I've been guilty of it. Although I am making a concerted effort to not be guilty of it anymore, that composers will write absolutely impossible things. Almost, mm. I wonder why. I mean, I think it's usually out of a place of fear of that they will be perceived as being too simplistic and therefore not creative enough, or I don't
mm-hmm.
know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so they'll write extremely complex rhythms that are it's just a pain to count, and the player is so obsessed with playing it properly that sort of deeper things in the music, like the thinking about balance and thinking about emotion, mm-hmm. or thinking about what goes into that, mm-hmm. There's no time for that. Mm, so and like I said, you know, I get to sit through orchestral rehearsals. I get to watch the players navigate the score. I get to talk to them at breaks, mm-hmm. And ask them questions. And then, of course, the workshopping of my own pieces, where I can say, you know, I walked into this workshop this week and said, guys, I'm here to learn. Mm. So what doesn't work, let me know. And great. Tell me why it doesn't work, more importantly.
Great. And yeah, I'm sure you're receiving a lot of feedback.
Great feedback, yeah.
Great.
I can't play that many notes in that short period of time. I can't... The moving between that note and the next note, it crosses a really awkward part of my instrument. Therefore, could we try something like this?
Interesting.
These kind of technical things are super helpful, and you don't know them otherwise.
Right. Well, I mean, like, we all spend so much time focusing on what we're trying to do really well.
Yeah.
That to know... that about every other person's instrument is how long a life can you have?
Exactly.
This is really exciting. So you are now in the second year.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming the premiere of your next work will be next season?
Yeah, it'll be at the opening of the 2019 season.
Great. And do you have any future projects on the horizon after this residency that you're really looking forward to?
Yeah. You know, I have this opportunity has certainly opened doors for me with other opportunities. And I'm really excited to say it's been recently announced that that I'll be actually the composer in residence for the Canadian Opera Company.
Hey!
For 2 years following my time here.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's a huge honor.
Thank you. So I'll write a work for their ensemble studio, a 50-minute opera. And I mean, that's just kind of an extension of this in some ways.
Man, you're getting to write opera now.
Oh yeah.
For an opera company.
It's incredible. And I mean, the best training that I've had here in terms of working with an orchestra and learning the orchestra so much better, and learning to write for so much better, hopefully, and then being able to transfer those skills to specifically thinking more intensely about the voice, and mm-hmm. then how all of the, because you add additional parts, moving parts to writing an opera. You've got singers, you've got mm-hmm. usually an orchestra, you've got you know, the drama on a stage, you've got costumes and sets, and you've got, you know, lighting and all of these.
All that adds extra complexities and variables.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That affect the music, really.
I'm sure.
Really and truly. So it's a great opportunity. I have just access to the resource of the Canadian Opera Company and their visiting artists and their staff, which are incredible. And we'll, continue
to write. Congratulations.
Thanks so much.
Look forward to hearing those works when they're premiered. That's great news.
Thank you.